be home for Christmas. You can plan on me. Please have snow and mistletoe and presents on the tree. Christmas Eve will find me where the love light gleams. I'll be home for Christmas, if only
Christmas classic was first recorded by Bing Crosby in 1943 at the height of World War II. It almost instantly became the most requested song at all by the American troops at all of the Christmas USO shows, both in Europe and the Pacific. The GI magazine Yank said, "Crosby has accomplished more for military morale than anyone else of the era." Ironically, the BBC banned the song from all of its broadcasts, believing that it would only serve to lower the morale of British troops. One author said that last melancholy line, "If only in my dreams," is a dagger in the heart of the lonely. Well, friends, this last month here at Legacy, we've been studying what the Bible has to say about some demonic villains, which always cause all of us continual suffering and pain, but which seem to take special delight in ruining our Christmases. Christmas, a season that we rightly associate with hope and with joy. Of course, soldiers far from home are not the only ones who experience loneliness. We have all at some time been engulfed by the foreboding darkness of loneliness. But this lying, joy-robbing servant of Satan called loneliness is especially active at the holidays. And any of you that have ever had an empty seat at the table at a Christmas celebration because of a death or a divorce or some other sad estrangement story, you know exactly what I'm talking about. A few years ago, all of our children went to their in-laws on Christmas Day, leaving Shara and I what we realized was for the first time ever in our lives all alone on this one day of the year. Now, we kept reminding each other how silly it was for us to have one sad thought because God had so richly blessed our family. We had these wonderful new son-in-laws and daughter-in-laws, and we knew that we were all going to be together with all the grandkids on December 27th. And yet still, throughout that day, we were tempted to wallow in the self-pity party of loneliness. But you all know, and will all at some point, or perhaps you have already this year, wrestled with the Christmas villain of loneliness. If you go out and Google loneliness, you will find that there are hundreds of scientific studies and opinion articles about this topic, because it's always been an issue for people. But today, more than ever before, many people seem to feel and be feeling lonelier and more isolated. Many blame technology for this, specifically social media. You see, online spaces, they tend to be status-oriented, and they exaggerate all the positive qualities of others while frowning on any honest confession or expression of loneliness or isolation. It is quite ironic that an invention that was designed to connect people has actually multiplied loneliness and social isolation in our society. But today's epidemic of loneliness, it's a well-documented fact. According to CBS News, 46% of Americans say that they feel lonely every single day. 53% say that they have zero meaningful real-life interactions with other people in their lives. Market Watch reports that 30% of our households now consist of only one individual, but 57% of Americans say that they typically eat all of their meals alone. 50% of Americans now take prescriptions to help combat emotional and physical problems caused at least in part by loneliness and social isolation. 10% of our elderly report that on a typical week, they'll go 5 to 6 days without seeing or speaking to another person. And 20% say that television is their main companion. The studies claim loneliness increases one's risk of death by 26%, and it has the basic same health impact as smoking 15 cigarettes a day. Prolonged seasons of loneliness reduces immunity, and as the lonely are more likely to turn to food for comfort, they are more prone to obesity and all of the accompanying issues of that. Strong correlations have been established between prolonged periods of loneliness and increased risk of heart disease, stroke, high blood pressure, clinical depression, cognitive decline, and dementia. Now, according to the literature, there are some things, there's some practical things that the studies prove we can do to help fight against loneliness. And it's interesting that some of these, you'll see this in a minute, they line up with some of the things that the Bible says. But a short list of the world's answer for loneliness includes, number one, adopting a pet. Apparently, pet owners are 36% less likely to self-report as lonely. And I know that during my recovery time, when I was home on oxygen, I always felt better with my little buddy. And I always enjoy the game more when my little buddy watches the game with me. Exercise, regular exercise, seems to offer others temporary relief from loneliness. And the studies all mention that intentionally practicing gratitude and actually getting out and serving others seems to help a lot of people fight against feelings of loneliness. For the last couple of weeks, I've been doing a pretty thorough Bible study on what the Bible says about this subject from Genesis to Revelation. And what I want to do today is I want to share with you, I want to kind of summarize my study by sharing with you five basic Bible truths which I think will equip us all in this season to vanquish the Christmas villain of loneliness. Number one, we need to recognize, I think the Bible teaches this, that we need to recognize that feelings of loneliness are a universal experience. Friends, at some point in life, everyone feels lonely. And just like all other human emotions and emotional responses to circumstance, there is no sin in initial feelings or an emotional response to a situation that you may or may not be able to control. But what we choose to do next, how we choose to act upon these universal feelings and natural emotions, this is where the great spiritual battle begins. As I read again this week the Christmas story in Matthew chapter 1, and I was reading it with the idea of thinking about loneliness, I thought about how lonely Joseph must have initially felt when he first found out that his betrothed had apparently betrayed him and was pregnant with another man's child. You see, Joseph did not initially know what Mary knew from the beginning, that all of this was part of God's plan. Verse 19 is clear. Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he was, look at this, as he was considering these things, as he's thinking about this, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. But you see, before that angel came in that dream and spoke to Joseph, he was considering. The Greek word ethumiomai carries with it the idea of deep, careful thought, of rational thought. But it also has in the word the idea of a struggle between your ideas and feelings of anger and feelings of frustration. Joseph was a just man. That means that his heart was righteous. It was a heart that wanted to please God. He wanted to do the right thing in every situation. But his emotions were telling him all kinds of things. And so what did he do? He thought deeply and he thought carefully, because he was determined that he would not be swept away or controlled by his quite natural human emotions. But then, after the angel explained, look what he did. After the angel came and explained what God was doing, and specifically what God wanted him to do, verse 24 says, when Joseph woke from his sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. He obeyed everything that the angel told him to do. Joseph would not surrender to his emotions, emotions that all of us understand and all of us have. He would not be controlled by feelings of anger or fear or betrayal or loneliness. And friends, as soon as he had that clear word from the Lord, as soon as he had his Bible verse, by faith, he obeyed it. And you know, we see the same thing in chapter 2. Imagine how he felt when God woke him up in the middle of the night and said, Joseph, take your family and flee to Egypt now. Go now. The child is in danger. He heard the word of God and he put his emotions aside and he did the thing that God had called him to do. But all of us need to recognize that all of our feelings, but especially our feelings of loneliness, are universal feelings. Friends, every hero of Scripture knew what it was in some season of their life to be very lonely. David, a man after God's own heart, he knew profound loneliness. We see it throughout the Psalms. In Psalms 25, 16, he cries out to God, turn to me and be gracious to me, for I am lonely and afflicted. In Psalms 142, verse 4, he laments, look to the right and see there is none who take notice of me. There's no refuge remains to me. No one cares for my soul. Psalms 102, verse 7 says, I lie awake. I'm like a lonely sparrow on a housetop. Friend, have you ever felt that kind of loneliness? You know, the Apostle Paul knew loneliness. Paul was surrounded always by an entourage of young men that he was mentoring and women that were serving with him, and he was planting churches everywhere, and he had friends everywhere. And yet when he got arrested and he went through this series of trials, which would eventually end up with him being beheaded because he preached the gospel, in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 16, he writes to his son in the faith, and he says, at my first defense, at my first trial, no one came to stand by me, but all deserted me. You can feel the loneliness dripping from the pen. Friends, Jesus knew loneliness. How do you think he felt in the Garden of Gethsemane when in his hour of anguish, he found his disciples sleeping? He said to them, "Could you not watch with me for 1 hour?" And how do you think he felt on the cross? About the 9th hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, "Oh, my God, why have you forsaken me?" There's a man feeling lonely. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 3 says, "He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, as one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not." We didn't even think about him in those moments. So the next time that you feel lonely, you need to recognize first that it's a natural and universal emotion, but it is not one that you should allow to control your behavior. And like Joseph and like David and like Paul and like Jesus, you should find your word from the Lord. What has God said? And you should obey it. Now, in order to hear this word from the Lord, we have to, number two, reject loneliness, but embrace solitude. We reject loneliness, but we embrace solitude. Friends, there's a big difference between being lonely and being alone. Those are two different things. Being alone can be good. It can be wonderful. Loneliness is always bad. In Genesis chapter 2, God said it's not good that man should be alone. One reason that God created marriage and the family, and then he called a people to be his own, to be a community before him, first ancient Israel, and today his church, his bride, his body, his family, is so that all of us who were created in his image would like him bless and be blessed by our encouraging and accountable fellowship with others. Friends, I can tell you today as a certainty that God has called you to live your life in community with others. He doesn't want you, your life dominated by loneliness. In the New Testament, the word is koinonia. And koinonia, we translate it usually fellowship or friendship. It describes intimate friendship. It describes lifelong partnership, that we're yoked together in the service of God. And in Acts 2, it says the early church was continually devoting themselves to the fellowship. And God wants you and I to do the same thing. Listen to me. God's will for your life is that with great energy and great intentionality, you would right now be pursuing the kinds of relationships where fellowship occurs, relationships within the church, within the body, within his forever family. You say, well, what about relationships with the world? Well, you can have those too, but those are unequally yoked, and you're only going to get so much back there. That's your mission field. In here is your family, your forever family. But this intense pursuit of fellowship with others, it is one means by which we actually worship and bring glory to God. When you are pursuing relationship, when you are partnering with other people in life, that is bringing glory to God. It's an act of worship when you do that. But it's also a spiritual discipline. It's something you can do that you can practice, which will cause you to grow in your faith. So fellowship it's very important. It's a Bible principle. However, and here's the contrast I want you to hear. There are times in all of our lives, and sometimes there are seasons in all of our lives, where God, for our own blessing and for our own spiritual growth and equipping for service, calls us to be alone in his presence. We're not really alone, but we're in his presence by ourselves. You see, just like fellowship, solitude is also a vital spiritual discipline. And by being alone in the presence of God, we also worship him and we also grow in faith. Jesus was a wonderful model of perfect balance between the pursuit of intimate fellowship with others. He called his disciples to be with him, and we see so much of his communal life. But also, he modeled for us the isolation of solitude with his Father. He began his ministry with 40 days of solitude in the wilderness. And there he fasted and he prayed and he did spiritual battle with Satan and with the temptations of his own flesh. And then we see throughout his ministry, he continued in this spiritual discipline of pursuing and embracing solitude. Listen to these verses. Matthew 14, 23 says, after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. And when evening came, he was still there all alone. Mark chapter 1, verse 35, rising very early in the morning while it was still dark, he departed and he went out to a desolate place and there he prayed. In Luke chapter 5, verse 16, he would withdraw to desolate places and pray. And friends, in all of those passages, the verbs are the Greek imperfect tense. And that Greek imperfect tense indicates to us that the Lord's rising early, his departing, his withdrawing to desolate places for prayer, this was not a one-time event. This was the habitual pattern of his life. It was part of his spiritual discipline. It was a practice. You see, just like every other Bible hero, you and I must reject the pity parties of loneliness. And somewhere along the way, we've got to embrace God's invitation to separate from people, to enter into his presence. And here's what we do there. We just be still and know that he is God. And frankly, friends, only when we have truly become comfortable doing that, being alone with God, being alone in the presence of God, only when you're comfortable doing that will you actually be a person equipped to fully enjoy and to fully encourage a spouse or a family or other intimate friends inside the church. Number three, in our solitude, we need to confess the truth that we are never really alone. We're never really alone. We're alone in the Lord's presence, and he is with us. Now, I want you to think through this, especially if you're one here today feeling lonely. God knows your situation, right? God knows everything. He knows your situation. God knows your heart. He sees your lonely feelings. And friends, God loves you. And so in the right time, in the right place, when you've learned all the lessons that you need to learn in the solitude, he's going to come and he's going to deliver you from these feelings. But we must regularly confess that faith. We must regularly confess that our God sees all and knows all and he loves us, and that eventually when the time is right, he's going to deliver us from the oppression of loneliness and from the struggle we have with this villain who would use loneliness to take us away from God. In Deuteronomy 31:6, Moses told God's people, "You be strong and courageous and do not fear or be in dread of them, of your enemies, for it is the Lord your God who goes with you, and he will not leave you or forsake you." In Psalms chapter 38, verse 9, David said, "Oh Lord, all my longing is before you. My sighing is not hidden from you." David acknowledged that all the things he was feeling, that he knew his God was watching. He knew his God knew those things. And sometimes David struggled with his feelings. He wanted to do the right thing. He wanted to follow his spirit, which is informed by the word, but his soul would fight against it with his emotion. And so in Psalms 42:11, we see David preaching the truth to himself. "Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God." In Psalms 27:10, he affirms, "For my father and my mother have forsaken me, but the Lord will take me in." Hear the words of Jesus. "I will not leave you in the world. I will not leave you as orphans, but I will come to you." Friends, do you believe that? Do you believe that promise of Jesus that he's not going to leave us as orphans here, but he's going to come to us? Listen, no matter how you might feel today, this is the Lord's command to you. This is the word you need to get up and go and do what he says. You are to go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, of all peoples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I've commanded. The command that Christ has given you is to make your life about His mission. Go on His mission with your neighbor, with your family, with your friends, with your coworkers. You focus on disciple making, planting the seeds, watering the seeds, cultivating the soil, feeding the new believers. And Jesus makes this promise: as you do that, behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Here's a fourth Bible truth about loneliness. God's comfort comes to us when we fully rely on Him. The psalmist says, "For God alone, oh, my soul waits in silence, for my hope is from Him." Isaiah said, "Fear not, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." And the apostle Paul in the New Testament writes, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God." And here's the promise: the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, it will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Over and over again, from Genesis to Revelation, Jesus, the Lord, says to His people, "Trust me, fully rely on me, and I will come to comfort you." You know, the honest truth is that the Lord is far too often the very last one that we turn to for our strength and comfort. Too often we run first to the refrigerator or to the TV or turn up the music or log on to the website. Over and over again, I've seen lonely people turn and take another drink, or they turn to some new, or they return to some old destructive behavior or toxic relationship. We turn to everything and everyone but God, all in this desperate attempt to escape the gnawing pain and emptiness of our own loneliness. But the real and lasting comfort of God, His incomprehensible peace, only comes when we quit looking for comfort in the world and we turn to Him and lay our all on the altar. Psalms 147:3 says, "He heals the brokenhearted and He binds up their wounds." 1 Peter 5 commands us, "Humble yourself, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time He may exalt you, casting all your anxiety on Him, because He cares for you." Philippians 4:19 promises, "And my God shall supply every need of yours according to His riches and glory in Christ Jesus." Well, Bible fact number 5 about loneliness is this, and it's married to fact number 4. It is God's plan to use us. Everyone that wears His name, everyone that calls himself His son or daughter, it is God's plan to use us to alleviate the loneliness of others. 2 Corinthians 1:3 said, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our affliction so that we may be able to comfort those who are in affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God." I want you to listen to this admonition from Hebrews chapter 13, beginning in verse 1. This is about loneliness. It may not be labeled that way in your Bible, but this verse is about loneliness. "Let brotherly love continue." This is what you need to focus on, loving your brothers. "And do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for whereby some have entertained angels unawares. And remember those who are in prison, as though in prison with them, and those who are mistreated, since you also are in the body." You see, all of God's children are called to minister to the lonely, whether they're people that are mistreated or oppressed, or whether they're just strangers in the new land or the new place, or whether they're in prison, they made mistakes and got themselves in all kinds of trouble. We're called to love them and to seek to alleviate their loneliness. And listen to this, because sex and money are the two idols that lonely people too often turn to. Verse 4 continues very specifically, "Let marriage be held in honor among all, and let the marriage bed be undefiled. For God will judge the sexually immoral and adulterous. And keep your life free from the love of money. And be content with what you have. For he has said, I will never leave or forsake you." Friends, in order to comfort others, we must be a people who know ourselves the comfort of God. And we got to be a people that understand that sex and some new illicit relationship or money or the things that money can buy, that's not going to fill the void. That's not going to solve the problem of loneliness. We've got to quit looking for the comfort of the world and seek the comfort of God. A.W. Tozer once said, "It is doubtful whether God can bless a man greatly until he has hurt him deeply." I want to repeat that. I want you to listen to this. It is doubtful whether God can bless a man greatly until he has hurt him deeply. Now listen, I think Tozer is right. I probably wouldn't say it that way. I don't like the idea that people will say, "Oh, I don't think God hurts people." Well, look, he either comes down and does it, or like Job, he steps back and lets Satan do it. God is sovereign. He's ultimately responsible for the trials we go through. And we know that he uses them all. I think Tozer is right. And friends, maybe right now, God is using the refiner fire of loneliness or some other trial or some other hardship in order to teach you to fully trust in him. And he's doing that now, so that in the days ahead, he can use you greatly in the lives of others. Friends, do not run from that trial. Embrace it. James says, what? Count it all joy, right? Because God is refining us. God is growing us. God uses these struggles with our feelings, our struggles with circumstances. He uses these things to build us up. Most of you know that earlier this month, I just got back from leading a group to the Holy Land, and I'm not really sure why this happened on this trip, but over and over and over, almost every day of our trip, I was reminded and I thought about Patty Scott. Now, those of you who don't know who Patty Scott was, she was a long, long time member and servant of Legacy Christian Church, and she was tragically killed last spring while on vacation. Her funeral here at the church was one of the largest and most impacting services I've ever officiated. In fact, I've never even done this before or heard of this. We had to have two services with overflow rooms in order to celebrate her life. Patty went with me to Israel, and this is why these things kept coming up. She went with me to Israel in 2017. And this year, everywhere we went, as I'm watching other people do the things Patty did, I had these images of her on that previous trip. They just kept invading my thoughts and my heart. I'll share some of the things I thought about. Here's Patty. She's sitting next to our guide as he explains to us the story of Caesarea. We're just a few feet here from the place where Peter preached the first gospel sermon to the Gentiles, and Cornelius became a Christian, and he told this whole story, and Patty is sitting there resting, and I took great delight in telling Patty in front of the whole group, as soon as the guide was done with the story, that she's actually sitting on a first century public toilet. And she's embarrassed me many, many times, and so this was a really fun thing for me to do. Here's Patty with Monica Butler from our Olathe campus on the Sea of Galilee. It was a special day for us. Here's Patty just figuring out why I had been yelling at her to stay away from this fence On the other side of this fence is a minefield, and I had been yelling at her, and you would think that a preschool director would be better at following instructions. And she goes, oh, and she realized why I had been yelling at her to stay away from it. Here's Patty riding a camel in Jericho. Here is Patty praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. And here are the two of us standing above the Valley of the Shadow, which David uses as a metaphor for death in Psalms 23. Now, as those who knew Patty on our group and trip, I mentioned that I had these thoughts that kept coming to me. I shared it, and as those that knew her were sharing with some of the others on our trip who didn't know Patty about her life and about her tragic death, but more about how encouraging she was and how dearly she's missed by so many in our church. One of our ladies said something like, she was just born with this outgoing, compelling joy and passion for people. And you know what? All of you that know Patty, you know that's true. That's true. But it is also true that Patty's life was filled with all kinds of trials and all kinds of hardships. And in spite of having a loving family and hundreds of friends and brothers and sisters in Christ, Patty, because, and I know this because she shared this with me on numerous occasions, she spent a whole lot of time in her life wrestling with the dark villain of loneliness. Early in her life, Patty was called as a mom to be the full-time caregiver of a severely disabled child. And then she became the full-time caregiver of a severely disabled adult. And she went through a painful and unwanted divorce. And she lived a long, long time as a single mom with four children. And there were some lonely years in there for her, even though she was supported and loved like few people I've known have been supported and loved. Then she met and she married, by the grace of God, this wonderful Christian man who came into her life. And they had this beautiful marriage. And then he became sick and died of cancer. And then single again, she waited on the Lord. And she suffered through some of the bad decisions that her children and grandchildren and other loved ones made. Friends, the truth is, God hurt Patty greatly. He allowed these things to come into her life. But it's also true that because she recognized that loneliness was a universal experience, and because she rejected loneliness but embraced solitude, because she regularly confessed the truth that we are never truly alone, and because she learned, I mean, her little thing, she had frogs all around, and frogs for her, she learned to fully rely on God. And because she learned that, she experienced God's miraculous comfort. And this is why she was able to be greatly used by Him to relieve much loneliness in the lives of some of you. Well, this is exactly what God wants to do today in your life and in my life. Let's work with Him. Father, we thank You for our time together. And Lord, we thank You that You've equipped us to fight the villain of loneliness. And Lord, I pray that we as Your people would not succumb to him, but that we would win Christmas, and that we would win the lives, the abundant lives that You died to give us. In Jesus' name, amen.